Good morning. How is everybody? That was a great keynote this morning. I really enjoyed that, especially the talk about the Lambda and the support for containers. I'm a huge Docker fan, so that was great to hear about that kind of stuff. Also, I always enjoy Godfrey Sullivan from Splunk speak. He's been a great friend to us. So my name is Michael Connor. I work with the Coca-Cola company in Atlanta, Georgia, and I'm the platform architect for all of our digital marketing systems. And so our talk today is about migrating to Amazon Web Services. We've had a lot of fun over the last year and a half, and I'm hoping we can share a lot of the insights, the things that we've learned, so that it can maybe help you in your journey. I actually remember the exact day when we started our move to the cloud. This was February 3rd, 2013, Super Bowl 47. I'm sure a lot of you watch this. This was between the Ravens and the 49ers, right? And this was a great game. And this is, Super Bowl is the apex of American sports, but it's also the forum where all of the best minds in advertising showcase the top ads. And so, of course, this is a very special time for Coca-Cola. And our marketing team had put together a fantastic campaign. All right, click one more. This is a story about our trials and tribulations with the Super Bowl are resonating right now. from the beginning. Yay, it's Showgirls. I figured it's a talk in Vegas, right? And we do have a high male to female ratio. So the campaign was Coke Chase. And this was, the campaign was actually to basically take, it was like these three fictional teams. It was the Showgirls, the Cowboys, and the Badlanders. And this was a race through the desert to win this giant Coke bottle. And so it was a great campaign put together by our marketing team. And it was one of those you call the ending type campaigns. So based on user votes online, we would actually swap out the final ad to reflect the choice of the viewers. And so the marketing team had placed a tremendous amount of confidence in my team to basically run the digital portion of this. There were calls to action to go online. And so we were really nervous about this. And this is a tall order. This to date, this had been the top, the most widely viewed television event in the history of mankind. Right? And our team was playing a part in this. So the stakes were high. We had prepared relentlessly for this event. And we were very excited. We felt very confident about it, though, because we were running on-prem at the time, but we had gone out and provisioned all this extra hardware. We'd done all this work to make sure that we tested everything. Day in and day out, we were doing testing. We tested to 10 times the actual amount of traffic that we expected for the Super Bowl. So game day, we were feeling pretty good about it. We were excited to watch the game, of course, too. And so first quarter, people are hitting the site, the ads are running, things are looking good, page times are under 3 seconds. Middle of the second quarter, things started to slow down a little bit. Page times, 6 to 8 seconds. We're still running pretty well, but we're on the phone with the ops team and we're seeing traffic was much higher than we'd ever expected it to be. So things started to get progressively worse. And by halftime, it was clear that we had major problems. So we're on the phone with the ops team and all of our servers are saturated. We're running out of sockets, we're bumping U limits, we're rebooting machines, spinning up new ones in real time. And so nothing we could do would get us ahead of the wave of traffic that we had. And so this ended up being a fairly poor user experience for the people that went to the site. And it was really hard for our team. The business and the marketing team had instilled so much confidence in us to execute this portion of the campaign, and we really felt like we let them down. So this was a tough time. I mean, getting up out of bed on Monday morning and going into work, you know, and facing these teams that we let down was a very hard thing for us to do. And so we realized at that point we had to change the way we think and the way we operate and start to look towards public cloud. And we'd been in this kind of situation before. I mean, anyone in IT, which is probably a lot of you, have been there, right? In an on-prem environment, if you don't provision enough capacity and something like this happens, it's catastrophic. And if you over-provision, then they come back and they can say, well, you know, we wasted a lot of money because the servers didn't get enough hits. So I felt like we've always been in this no-win situation. And so from that day, we decided to move forward with public cloud. And a year and a half later, I'm proud to say that our final site is going live on Tuesday, And I think at the end of next week or within the next couple of weeks, we'll be able to turn off our final on-prem servers. So that's a great win for us. So hopefully, I think something very good is come out of something bad. And I think that happens in life too. The Super Bowl event actually gave us the awareness and gave us the business case to move forward to public cloud. Coke is a very big company, and it's not always easy to kind of push people forward. In a big event like this, we're actually able to capitalize on the issues that we had to enable us to move to the public cloud. Okay, so what are we going to talk about today? I know we're a technical group, but you can't really get into the cloud without making a business case. And I'd like to go through just a few things on vendor selection process. Spoiler, I'm here talking at Amazon. Right? But I think there's a few key things that you should understand. I mean, everyone has to go through legal and procurement in your organization, and they may not always see things the same way that you do, right? So you've got to make your case. The cloud presents a whole new suite of architectural challenges. So I'd like to talk about those and talk about some of the things that we faced, and then actually go through the solutions that we found to those problems. Finally, we'll talk about the results. And just in case any of you guys have to bail early, I'll talk to these really, really briefly, and then we'll go through in more detail at the end. But we were able to achieve a 40% operational savings. Through my life, if we were able to show a 3%, 4%, or 5% gain, off our operational budget, that was a big win. It's something that we were excited about. This is a 40% drop in our operational budget. And we also had an 80% reduction in our help desk tickets. So everything started to be automated, and we were a lot more efficient, and it was a lot of fun. And so it was exciting. We were actually writing a check back to the business, and that doesn't really happen in IT. So that was the big wins for us, and we'll go into details on how we got there. So the business case, and the business saw why we needed the public cloud, but at the same time, no one's going to green light a data center move and the risk associated with that and all the effort without knowing what the costs are going to be, if there's going to be savings, and what the operating model will be going forward. So you have to present that. And before we touch on that, it's important for you to understand our model. Every company is different, and understanding this model will help you understand why we made some of the decisions that we've made. So Coca-Cola, for us, scale is always the primary issue. So 1.9 billion servings per day we sell. 500 brands we market to 207 countries. We have 750 products that we sell in North America alone. And my group does a lot of promotions. We have over 100 promotions that we do per year. And so a lot of these promotions, we put them together very quickly. We have to get them out. Hopefully tens of millions of people will see these promotions, and then we're going to take them down. This is stuff like Super Bowl, Final Four, a lot of other promotions that we do, American Idol. And so again, we want to bring them up quickly, quick time to market. They have to meet security requirements. So they have to be done right, but then we're going to take them down. So these aren't long-running campaigns that we do. And we also have high agency turnover. Our agencies are very creative. And so in a lot of situations with architecture, you can train people. We don't really have that luxury, because by the time you train someone, a lot of times they've moved on to another company. So that's a big factor for us. So making the case for the cloud, for my group, there's a lot of technical issues that we care about. But for the business, they tend to focus more on price. Reliability, price, time to market. So that's where we focused. And so the way that we did this was we went on-prem, we looked at every server we had, every SAN, every NAS, every asset, every backup system, and we basically priced that out in the cloud. And we couldn't believe it. When we summed it up in Excel, it was a ton of Excel spreadsheets. When we did that, it actually was 10% more expensive to be in the cloud. And that was a head scratcher, because everyone was talking about the wonderful cost savings. And so we were working with two of our partners at the time, Second Watch, which runs ops for us. Jeff Aiden from Second Watch is here, and John Peake from Canada Partners. And these guys, they had to coach us on how to do this. And they taught us you really have to rethink the way you operate. We've been in an on-prem data center for 2 decades. And the way we had done things, we had done that for a long time. Old habits are really hard to break. And so, for example, they taught us that you can turn things off. And you guys know this well from a lot of the keynotes and the discussions here. But turn off test, turn off staging, QA environments. If your QA teams run from 8 to 5, you can turn those environments off from 5 to 8. There's a huge amount of cost savings there. So turning things off, automating stuff, that's how we achieved an 80% reduction in tickets, is because we don't do a lot of things manual anymore. Almost everything that we do is fully automated, and so we've saved a lot of money on our operations budgets. And then we're also running in Elastic environments. I want to go into detail on this later, but the Elastic environments are also a huge part of the cost savings that you're going to get. We also rethought some of our architectures. we always did things the same way. You need a site, okay, we have Oracle, we have WebSphere, we have Java, we're gonna do it the same way. We're gonna have test, we'll have staging, we'll have prod. And some of these sites were brand sites. They were static sites, product information, product locators, nutritional information and things like that. And we realized that a lot of these sites, we were paying about $20K a year for a lot of these small sites. Didn't get many hits. And we realized by moving those to S3 and putting CloudFront on them, we could actually take that cost down to under $1,000. So rethinking architectures, environments that were $20K are now under $1,000. And also they're all infinitely scalable and they never got hacked, right? We don't have to patch those kinds of environments because Amazon does it for you. So our final cost estimates showed savings at around 20%. So that's what actually gave us the green light. People were happy about that. And we were able to show that the investment we could make in the migration would be returned fairly quickly to the business. So we got the green light there. So my team is on the more technical team. We had been suffering from a lot of issues technically that we wanted to solve. And so these are not issues that the business cared about, but things that were near and dear to our hearts. Here's the showgirls again. Super Bowl was top of mind, right? We had to solve that. And then also, we knew that the costs were high, but we also wanted metered billing. A lot of the sites, again, we have 100 promotions. They're managed by different business owners. And we really had no way to tell anybody how much each site cost and give them a return on investment. So we're doing much more data-driven decision-making in Coca-Cola. For everything that we do, we want to know what the impact was and what the return on investment is. And that way, we can start to optimize our spend and really push money towards the more successful activities. We had a restrictive technical environment. PHP, Java, and .NET, that's all we offered. Oracle was the only database. And all these guys coming out of school are asking for Node, Python, Ruby, especially in the agencies. They want to do the cool stuff. And so they didn't like it when we said, well, here's Tomcat, or here's WebSphere in Java. It just couldn't be very efficient that way. We also had little visibility in the environment. So on the SWAT call with the Super Bowl, they're telling us memory settings, they're telling us CPU, but a picture's worth 1,000 words. It's very hard for the people that develop the application to figure out what's going on if they can't see things. And that's been the security model for on-prem, right? Well, we're gonna run this. If you wanna see anything, submit a ticket, 2-hour SLA, we'll get to it, we'll send it back to you. And that just didn't work anymore. Super Bowl type events would also cause problems for other sites. So a wave of traffic comes in for the Super Bowl, it not only takes down that site, but it took down the rest of our clusters. And the same thing for denial of service attacks. These are becoming much more prevalent. We were dealing with some of this stuff last week. It's becoming much more prevalent. And also hacking. You don't want an intrusion into a single system to affect your other systems. So we really wanted full isolation so that any issues we had with a single site or system wouldn't affect the rest of them. And the businesses always complain about maintenance windows. I was a global architect for a while, and we would take these maintenance windows for the United States, and we would take them off hours to the United States. Well, that'd be prime time for Japan. And they always complained about this. And they did a ton of digital work. And so downtime for deployments was also an issue. Whenever you deploy code, you kick the users off your website, right? And then they got to log back in again. So those were things that we've been dealing with for a long time. And then accountability. So Coke, we're a refreshment company. We don't want to have a ton of technical people. We don't want to solve a lot of technical problems, right? We want to quarterback those things and work with partners and work with agencies to get this stuff done. And so you have a lot of teams involved. And in an event like the Super Bowl, the agency's pointing fingers at the ops team is pointing fingers at the agencies, and we're left trying to sort it all out. So we wanted to move to a model where a single team had full accountability for the entire experience. So for example, the DevOps model, I'm sure you've heard a lot about it, or you've already embraced it, the developers have much more control over the hardware and the environments. They'll actually reach out to our operations team and get advice, get help, but at the end of the day, if something goes down, if there's any problems, it's squarely on the agency, and that level of accountability has improved things for us a lot. So the vendor selection process, we'll just touch on this quickly. Again, we're in Amazon, but a lot of these are self-evident, so I just wanted to touch on a couple of these. The managed capabilities, I think, are the most important. And the reason is some of the vendors that we spoke to, we'd say, do you have MySQL? Of course. You know, go, yum, install MySQL, you're up and running. Do you have, that's MySQL, do you have NoSQL databases? Yeah, you can go in and install Mongo and get that up and running very quickly. And I think that appeases a lot of people that don't know a lot about the underlying technical details. But whenever you have a platform, you have to operationalize it. So you have to patch things, you've got to back things up, do restores, there's like tuning and things like that. And so every Everything you operationalize, every technology you embrace, has a cost on the tail end. So we get two bills at the end of the month. We have our infrastructure bill, and then you have your services bill. And if you're working with a cloud vendor that doesn't have these managed capabilities, your services bill is going to be a lot higher. So for example, DynamoDB is one of my favorites. It's a NoSQL, fully managed environment. And I costed this out recently. You're actually able to spin up in minutes a NoSQL database. It'll do 50 billion reads a day and 1 billion writes per day. It's fully managed, redundant across three availability zones. They patch it, they deal with it. And you get one bill. And so to do that, if we were just running in kind of a VMware type environment where we're spinning up machines, we would have to have a team of probably 10 people to manage an environment like that. So S3 is actually incredible. Not only can you run sites on S3, it's actually a, it can be like a drop-in replacement for HDFS, and you can run like MapReduce clusters on S3. So the managed capabilities, I think, were the most important thing that we looked at. And then also the automation. So a lot of the efficiencies gains that we wanted to get stem from automation, and a lot of vendors didn't have it. They said that they would, but you asked for the API docs, and they'd have like 30 or 40 APIs running. So at the height of this, you're never going to get a big organization. You'll never get everybody aligned on a single vendor. I think it's impossible. And so there was a lot of back and forth, a lot of debate. And kind of in the middle of this, Gartner released their magic quadrant. And I don't know if you guys are familiar with these, but so the way that these work is you want to be in the top right. You know? And so I've never actually seen a Gartner Magic Quadrant that looks like this. Amazon Web Services is actually at the very top right of this, and there's nowhere and even no one's even close. And so when actually our execs saw this, this lined up perfectly with the analysis that we had done. And so I think that gave everyone a lot of confidence that we could move forward with that. So architecture. I think that the role of the architect is to understand the business opportunity and understand their business, look at the capabilities, and then very carefully choose the capabilities to bring in the organization. When you choose those capabilities, you have to really think a lot about your model. So back to like our scale and our issues and our technical abilities, we don't have a lot of technical people in-house. There's a lot of capabilities in Amazon that we simply could not operationalize. This is familiar to you if you have an AWS account. These are all the capabilities. They actually have a ton more. I think you could probably build a career on just a couple of these. There's so much complexity behind every single one of them. Right, so when we're looking at this, we said, oh, well, we could just have one account. We could turn 100 agencies loose and give them root. And we'll see where that takes us. So all of a sudden, we start thinking, well, how do we scale this? How do we secure this, make sure it scales, deal with agencies that a lot of times don't have a lot of technical abilities? And so that was the challenge. We actually went into to reInvent last year, and we were hoping to come out with these. We sat in a session that two lovely ladies from Nike gave. It was Ann Wallace and Amber Milovec. And I think that they're also presenting this year. I think microservices, they did a talk on that yesterday. But they had done this, they were ahead of us, and they shared all of the things that they had learned, and they saved us so much time and money. That's a part of why we're here today, too, is because we'd like to pay that forward, and hopefully you can get some value out of the lessons that we learned. But we were trying to figure out, let's take auto-scaling, for example. Auto-scaling is a very, very complex capability in Amazon. If I turned an agency loose with auto-scaling, either I'd have to do a lot of training, or we'd have to revert to the ticket process. They'd have to go back to the ops team, and we'd have to hire a lot more ops people. And so when you're looking at auto-scaling, you want this, but we really couldn't operationalize this. And so access to new platforms. We didn't have teams of people that knew Chef and Puppet that could manage all these different platforms. The cost to give you all the platforms that we wanted would probably be around $2 to $3 million. So that was a non-starter for us. Visibility, we talked about. In metered billing, there's ways to do metered billing in Amazon, but you have to tag every resource. So that means everything you do, every bucket, every machine has to be tagged. And then there's reconciliation at the end of the month. So again, we're trying to figure out, here's this great capability, but we couldn't really figure out how to make it work. And we wanted to secure isolated environments. We wanted a separate data center for every single environment. But data centers are very complex and very, very difficult. And again, we'd have to have a team of five to do that. We didn't have that kind of budget. And we wanted the zero downtime deployments, but we've been trying to get that for two decades. With all the resources that we had, we could not operationalize that. And so we wanted that. But again, it looked like it was going to be too difficult to figure that out. And so we wanted to move to the simple self-serve DevOps model. But again, you need dashboards, you need all these tools. It's really complex to do that and very expensive. And so so we were really frustrated in trying to figure these things out. So coming out of reInvent last year, we had solutions to almost every single one of our problems, solutions that were scalable for our business and the way that we operate in the model we have. So again, you have to think through these. This is going to be different. If you have a long-running platform, you have two or three apps, and a single dedicated team in your company, the model that you pick is going to be different. Right? So this is very tuned to the human scalability issues that we have. Okay, so reInvent to the rescue. For all the different issues that we had, we found solutions to these. And it's good to know that also these are all free. Elastic Beanstalk is free. Python we use for automation. Boto is a great Python framework. Splunk is actually the one that's not free. But that is a very, very powerful tool. We're going to get into that later. But also, CloudFormation, VPC, these are all free technologies. You only pay for the things that you use. So we were able to come up with solutions for all of our business problems out of reInvent last year. And almost all of them were free. So penguin curling, what I want to do is I want to walk through migrating a single site, take it all the way through so you understand that completely, and then we'll talk about doing like a mass migration with thousands of sites. So penguin curling, Wieden Kennedy is a great agency. These guys are actually here today. Brilliant people. They're brilliant creatively, but they're also very technical. And so we had this application, Penguin Curling. It was a game. And this is very cool. It's a Java-based platform. But if you see it in the bottom right, it's kind of hard to see it. But you can actually piece together different devices, iPads and iPhones, and play a game across all of them. And so they built that with Java and the composite framework, which is open source. And Coca-Cola probably contributes to that. And so So this is also a very scalable app. I mean, we didn't know how much traffic this would get, but it ended up getting huge amounts of traffic, 28 million requests per day. And again, we're running hundreds of promotions in parallel. So let's walk through this entire case study from beginning to end. So the first thing that an agency does is they submit tickets. You're familiar with this. This is an internal system that we've already got. And they specify some things that the ops team needs to know about. Once the ops team gets it, this is a second watch. This is where the exciting things happen. So the way we've done accounting, I think, is a little bit controversial. And I've had a lot of people at Amazon tell me that they don't think we're doing it right. But I'm convinced this is the right approach. We have a single parent account. And for every asset that we manage, we have a separate sub-account in Amazon. And what that gives us is metered billing down to the penny, a full accounting list of everything that we use down to the penny. And it also helps us with security. Right? So I can give Wieden Kennedy access to that site, access to all those resources, and they can come in and do their work and not worry about another agency coming in and vaporizing some of their machines, right? And agencies, they do a lot of different things that you don't expect. And so this creates a total segregation between all of our sites and all of our agencies and assets. Everything we do is automated. So when we bring this site to life, SecondWatch actually kicks off CloudFormation with Python. CloudFormation is a technology that I'm so excited about. I think if you take nothing away from this presentation, know that CloudFormation can totally change configuration management for your business going forward. This is the data center we wanted to run. This is very complex. It's got subnets. You know, you've got your DMZ, gateways. There's security, ingress, egress, ports. These are very complex. It takes a lot of smart people to build these. And so we wanted one of these for each site, but we couldn't figure out how to scale that up. And the agencies couldn't do that. And so CloudFormation actually gives us the ability to define a data center using a JSON file. It's about, I think most of our templates are about 300 to 400 lines of JSON. And it's great because once you've captured that and the architects and everybody signs off on this, security team signs off on this, you can click play and it will actually bring that data center to life in about 10 minutes. And so that's cool, but I think the really cool part is a little bit more subtle. So we check these into GitHub. You check this into GitHub, and if anyone goes to make a change, like let's say on this example to the some of the security ports, if they make a change, I know who made the change, when they made the change. I've got a comment on why they made the change. And then you can actually do like the diff to see the exact numbers and things that they changed. So this is a total game changer in terms of configuration management. And also, as an architect, I've always been frustrated. I can come up with designs all day, but if the agencies and ops teams don't follow those, it doesn't really help. You'll just still get chaos. And so this gives me the ability to have full control over every stack we run. The ops team clicks play on this. This thing comes to life in 10 minutes. And so CloudFormation, that's a free technology. So quickly on automation, we actually, when we were looking at all this stuff, we had paid a visit to our bottlers. And we were amazed at how much automation our bottlers have. I mean, there's no one screwing caps on Coke bottles. But In IT, every day, everything we wanted to do was submitting a help desk ticket, right? And it just, that just didn't make any sense. If anyone should be automating and leading automation, it should be IT. And so so we took inspiration from our bottlers, and we automate every single thing that we do. And that eliminates tickets, 80% reduction in tickets, which means less headcount on the ops team. It eliminates mistakes, so we're not resubmitting things when there's problems. It used to be to submit a firewall rule change, you'd submit it, there was a week, we had to wait for a week to get the window, and then somebody would always screw something up. The CIDR range or something would always be screwed up. You'd resubmit it and wait another week for that. So that's 2 weeks in to get a single port open. So automation solves all that. It's done in minutes, and it's always Six Sigma. I think it's something that our bottlers would be proud of. So it guarantees consistency and adherence to the architecture, and there's a huge increase in productivity. The agencies would submit requests for sites, and then it would take a couple weeks a lot of times to get all the assets they needed. So they're sitting on their hands where they could be doing more productive work. So here's an overview of the architecture, Minecraft inspired. This is, everybody's into Minecraft now. And you've heard a lot about this. So we have two zones, two availability zones. We use Route 53, and we'll talk about that more later. Elastic Beanstalk manages our application servers. And all this comes online. I think it would be about 6 weeks of work to bring this online without some kind of automation. And so we use Splunk for what I call operational omniscience. It gives us the ability to see everything that happens in our environments. And so once the environment's set up, agencies can go in and choose their platform. Again, we only had a few platforms before. So it's amazing the power that's behind this dropdown. I estimate probably $2 to $3 million for us to manage all these platforms, to have the Chef and the Puppet scripts and versions. And there's a lot behind each one of these. So we can literally select a platform, and all of that is up and running end to end in seconds. And Elastic Beanstalk takes care of that for us. And so back to auto-scaling. This is a very challenging thing to do. Auto-scaling takes a lot of training. It's easy to screw it up, but we want the power out of it, right? So Elastic Beanstalk has made a lot of this stuff easier. So an agency can now come in and do all of their auto-scaling in about 5 minutes with almost no training. And this is what gives us the price savings, the cost savings I was talking about, but also gives us that vertical scalability. And so in this instance, we see that we're going to run M3 extra large. We need a minimum of 6 instances running at all times, and we're going to burst up to 50. We don't want that to be infinite because we don't have an infinite amount of money for each campaign. In some campaigns, like the Super Bowl, we would. But on something like Penguin Curling, there's a budget associated with that, and so we'll often put a cap on that. And we're going to say, if the CPU utilization gets over 80, add new instances, and if it drops under 10, we're going to pull instances away. So 5 minutes of work, and we've got auto-scaling. This is something the agencies can do. And there's books, there's blogs, there's training. It's easy for these guys to come up to speed. And they're also doing this with other clients now. So it's not a proprietary process we created that they have to learn. Oops. I just want to make sure everyone fully understands why this saves costs. The way we used to run is, if your peak capacity was in the middle of the day, you'd always have to provision 50 servers to handle that peak capacity. So you're paying for 50 servers year-round. I looked at our Japan cluster last August, and it ran 80% idle, and we had 50 servers 80% idle in August. And so you're paying for those around the clock. So what we get with Elastic Beanstalk in auto-scaling is we can set the baseline capacity to 6, and that handles traffic throughout the day. But if we do get a spike, then we can quickly auto-scale up, launch new servers, and we'll pay for those by the hour. So everything in Amazon and servers is paid for by the hour. So what that means is instead of paying for 50 servers a year, we're paying for more like 10 to 12. So that's like a 70, 75% cost reduction right there just by doing the auto scaling. And then also we can handle things like, we never know when a promotion is gonna go viral. And so this is always, it's always nice to know that this is there if we do get hit. Like all someone has to do is post a tweet or put something on Facebook and you can get tens of thousands of hits. And so you want auto scaling as much as you can. The agencies also, the self-serve model, again, back to, we don't want them submitting tickets, we want them to control their environments. Elastic Beanstalk, you can literally go in, point click, upload your application, it deploys in minutes. The more sophisticated agencies are all doing things with Git. And so Elastic Beanstalk actually allows you to do a quick change to your code, make a commit, you do EB deploy, and it pushes all of your code out to the server, just the deltas, and it handles all the details for you. So it'll shut down servers, it'll spin up new servers, it will like restart the applications. Whatever it needs to do to get your application up and running, it takes care of for you. So I'm actually able to push a change out into production in about 30 seconds if we need to. And then the agency can tune the application. So the agency, the people that wrote the code best know how to tune it. And so this is a dashboard the Elastic Beanstalk again gives you. Agencies can come in, they can see the average latency, they can see every single machine, all of the errors, the logs, CPU utilization, all of these details the agency can see, and they can tune their application. This data a lot of times doesn't mean anything to the operations team, but the agency can see something and say, wow, memory is way too high on this machine, something's wrong, and then they can fix their code. So that's Beanstalk that gives you that full visibility. So Beanstalk is very good at giving you visibility in DevOps on a single site, but what it's not great at doing is giving you visibility and control over all of your sites. And so again, we can have hundreds of sites globally. I think we had 1,200 sites. So that's a lot to manage, and you want visibility on security, performance, all these key metrics. You want that across all of your sites for your operations team. So that's when Splunk comes in. Splunk actually gives us visibility into all the environments. This is a graph of all the inbound security threats to our environment. This is all in real time. And so we're able to see security attacks and defend those much better than we ever were before. And then Splunk also gives us access to fraud data. So anything that happens on our machines, any login we see, this is actually an animated interactive globe. It's much more impressive when you're running it. But this shows logins to our flagship loyalty program, MyCoke Rewards, from around the world. This is a North America-only based program. And so you see most of the traffic's coming through the United States. Some of it's also coming from Africa and Asia. And a lot of sometimes those are military bases, but a lot of times those represent fraud. So we're able to detect fraud much more quickly. Usually, you guys are probably very familiar with grep. We used to grep through thousands of logs, terabytes of data, right? And even just getting off the machines was hard. So literally, if I can say nothing else about Splunk, it is super grep. You can find anything you need to know about your environment within seconds. And so people ask me what the orange line is. That's actually our health monitor. It's pinging the site all the time. And then it's amazing, all the data we run through our data centers, our applications, how little intelligence we've given back to the business over the years. Because again, it's locked in these log files, right? And it's someone using grep. So Splunk is actually enables us to build these business intelligence dashboards that give real insights back to our business. So this is an example. When you swipe a card at a vending machine, that transaction goes through Amazon, it goes through Beanstalk, and that goes into a log file. That means Splunk has access to it. So within a couple hours, there's about 15 to 20 panels in this dashboard for our vending system. But within a couple hours, no coding, we're able to give business intelligence back to the business. And this panel, for example, it allows the business user to compare vending across two channels, business professional office parks and malls. And there's a drop down for each channel. But you can start to see when people are drinking and get a lot of insights about our consumers, things that help us optimize our business and our media spend. So when we're coming to the business and we're showing them how they can increase revenues, it's a seat at the table for IT instead of just running the operations. We're actually a bigger part of the business than we were before. I skipped a slide, so I'm going to go back quickly. The zero downtime deployment was something that Elastic Beanstalk also gives us, and this we're very excited about. And this is the click of a button. This is a tremendously complex endeavor that they've basically hidden behind a single button. So the way this works is we run two production environments that are mirror. Green is up and running currently. The agency can deploy then to blue. Right, so all the traffic is currently coming into green. You can kick the tires on blue, make sure it looks good, there's no errors in the deploy, and when you're ready, you swap URLs. All the traffic then starts to flow into blue, and then you can make sure everything's okay, right? If you start to see in Splunk, you start to see errors, 500s, 404s, you can click the button back and revert. So within a few seconds, you're back on your old environment, and you can fix whatever the problem is. And so the users also don't even know this happens. And the way we do this is we actually externalize the user sessions, and we'll talk about that more in a minute. But the users are never even aware that this happens. And so we have zero downtime deployments. And again, this comes to us free with Elastic Beanstalk. So everyone's very excited about that. So everybody cares about the bill. A lot of times the agencies will make projections on how much these things are going to cost. The business cares about the bill. I care about the bill. And this is, again, the separate accounts. If you can use separate accounts, it'll tell you every resource you have down to the penny last month and this month. So let's get into mass migration. So that's, I hope you see now, basically the architecture for a single site. So globally, we had 1,200 sites that we were looking at migrating, and we needed to do it in short order. So of course, the business comes back to us and said, well, what are the risks here? What's the critical path? What resources do we need to line up? How much is all this gonna cost? And so again, we're not a tech company. We're not great at technology. We had a lot of applications where we didn't even have the source code. And some of the agencies had moved on. We no longer had contracts with these guys. So we were really worried. And we found a tool called WindUp. It's open source and free. Highly recommended if you're doing a migration. And what this tool will do is it'll actually go into your WAR file, decompress it, go into every single Java class file you have, decompile the class file, and go through every single line of code looking for issues that need to be remediated when you move to the cloud. So for example, like a static IP address or a fixed endpoint, it'll find that and report that back to you. So for all sites, you know, over 1,000 sites, we have a PDF report that tells us every single thing that needs to be fixed. And so also we added, you can add your own rules. We added our own rules, things that we knew were issues with our environment. And we also did a little bit of accounting magic with Excel. So for every single site, I knew exactly how much it was gonna cost, who was needed to do the job. Was it the agency or the ops team? How long it would take? We were able to create a full critical path plan, and it was amazing how accurate this really was. So when we move things, also, I would really recommend an agile approach. For a lot of people, they think agile means that there's no process whatsoever. So if somebody in your organization, if you ask them what the process is they're running and they say agile, ask them to describe the product backlog. And then if they can't answer, then that means they're running with no process whatsoever. So we ran agile, and I highly recommend that. And start with the easy sites first. So a lot of the sites that were static sites, we moved to S3. We started there. So it created a lot of momentum psychologically. The business sees a bunch of sites being migrated quickly, and we got a lot of cost savings for that. And then we learned. So when we got to our flagship program, which we're releasing next week, we didn't have a lot of lessons to learn. We've already learned a lot of the lessons. And so here's another thing. A lot of people are going to tell you that moving a data center is easy. And there was a term I heard that kept being thrown out in our teams called, they kept saying lift and shift. And first of all, anytime someone tells me something that rhymes, I'm immediately suspicious of what they're saying. And so lift and shift is the idea that we could pick up an application, drop it in the cloud, and it was going to miraculously work. And that's absolutely not the case. You will probably have to touch every single application. So again, the wind-up tool tells you which applications and how much. It tells you down to the line of code. And so so that's really helpful. But there is work to do. And then also, this stuff, you have to code your apps differently. So the zero downtime deployment, we were actually, let's take an example. If you've got 10 servers running, and then all of a sudden you get a wave of traffic, you want to spin up 10 new ones, well, you've got to distribute all of your users across those new ones. And when the traffic wanes, you need to vaporize those servers so you're not paying that money. But none of that is possible if your sessions are living and they're pinned to a server. And that's the way most people do stuff today. The session's tied to the Tomcat server or whatever server we're running. So we actually externalize those sessions into memcached, and that's how you get that zero downtime deployment. That's how we're able to bounce servers, do deployments, swap environments, and get and not affect the users whatsoever. The 12-factor app, I'm not gonna go through these, this is online, but you can go and there's 12 things that you need to know about disposability of servers. You should be able to delete servers very quickly. That's one of the things that the 12-factor app talks about. So get familiar with these, share this with the development teams, and make sure when you're looking at these apps, that you're following the 12-factor app. If not, you're not gonna get a lot of the cost savings and auto-scaling that you're hoping for. So you can move it, but don't expect to save a lot of the money I had a short one on my other deck, it didn't come through, but I wrote a markdown document, and you can also reach out to me and I can share this link with you. This is a markdown document that'll tell you how to externalize sessions, it'll give you the code to do it, basically walk you through the reasons and how to set up Memcache and all that kind of stuff. So that's a big help for us, and it's very scalable. So a couple comments on security. You're always going to deal with security. People that have been in on-prem, the security teams, you're going to have to bring them along, educate them, teach them. Amazon's been great at helping us with that. They bring partners on that are really good with security and help our security teams understand why we're more secure in the cloud. But I think what you have to do is look at all the capabilities and figure out what you're going to operationalize. If you go to your security team and say, hey, bless the cloud for us, they'll never do it. So figure out like HIPAA or what security requirements they have, get that list of requirements and meet every single one of those requirements, and they'll be okay with it. If you just say bless the cloud, it'll never happen. So lastly, Beanstalk does a lot for you. It's free. I'm a big I'm a big advocate of it, but they don't patch your app for you. And because if they patched your app, it could break it. And then you wake up in the morning and your app is down because they patch it. So they'll tee up the security patches for you, but they won't actually patch your application. You have to have smart people that know how to do that, either internally or in your ops team, and you have to manage that. I saw a great keynote speech at Splunk. It was given by the guy who manages security for the NASDAQ Department of Energy. We've entered a new phase in terms of security. Poodle, Heartbleed, all of these attacks that have come out this year, we're seeing attacks that are coming almost every month, every other month, very serious attacks you have to deal with. I think before it was about every year we'd have something major, and the security piece is something you have to get ahead of. Actually, at Amazon, the Elastic Load Balancer is essentially the contact point for all of our traffic. So actually, Amazon patches a lot of stuff for you, like the OpenSSL issues were solved by Amazon. We didn't have to do anything. But security is something that you have to consider and deal with. So quickly go through the results. Costs are down 40%. We moved nearly 100 sites in 9 months. We had a team of 6 people, and that includes a PM. We had a second watch. That's our full team. We had a guy, Preston Holmes, who was amazing from Amazon, wrote a lot of the Python for us. And so everything we did is fully automated. And we have a simple auto-scaling for all of our environments. It's free and easy to use, fully metered. We have access to tons of different tech stacks. Splunk has given us operational omniscience. We got the ROI on Splunk back in about 2 weeks, by the way. So it is a paid product, but it's really worth it. And we have full isolation for each site, zero downtime deployments, and also the DevOps model is great. Agencies are happy, they're more efficient than ever. They're focusing on building beautiful, great experiences for us. So lastly, I just want to thank some of the partners. I've talked about these guys. Second Watch for operations has been great for us. We didn't have that cloud expertise. Canon Partners helped us with the architecture, and the Amazon Web Services has been fantastic, and also Wieden Kennedy is one of our premier agencies. So thank you to our partners, and thank you guys for being here. Good luck.